Good morning, and though I'm meeting you on the third day of the conference, I would like to welcome you as well to this institution. From my side, to help in better questioning, I'll assure you I'll stop in about 12 minutes or so. I have totally 5 slides. One is a title slide, one is a thank you slide. So that leaves us with only 3 slides. So, but there are a couple of aspects that I do want to flag, point out, and then we'll have questions depending upon you've written it up or otherwise. Yeah, so let me, the title is very, you know, being from a law background, I cannot give you simple sentences. So I have put it in a slightly elaborate manner, but I think the idea is to make it look more purposive. Right? Is it time for us to look at copyrights in a newer way, right? Is it time to revisit certain aspects? But surely we can't wish it away. So we can't just say that, no, we don't want people to be enforcing copyrights against us. That's not something that will ever happen. So we need to look at what are the spaces available, especially for public access, which is what I suppose today's theme of interaction is. So that's how there are a few aspects. I'm sure all of us know about IPRs. Amongst all the forms of intellectual property, copyrights is the most trickiest. Right, even lawyers love copyrights precisely because of that. Right, it's very tricky, very difficult to define, very difficult to even, you know, just to give you an example, what is a literary work? It's an inclusive definition. Right, there are many things included, there are many things being considered to be included. We now have copyrights extending to performance, right, the way I talk to you is also a form of copyright if I wish to kind of claim it with some, depiction. So copyrights is inherently, whether we like it or not, very amorphous, very difficult to confine, which makes it difficult for us to say, no, we haven't violated somebody's copyrights, right? So that's the converse part of it. Which I'm sure all of us are again aware. I'll just put these up, these numbers, just to spell it out. I don't think any of us are unaware of this section of our Copyright Act, especially from Indian context. This is the provision which spells out, and it really spells out, as you can see. Right? In fact, 32 categories. Right, more than 20, 23 or 24 subcategories, which means that many spelling out of what will not amount to infringement. And yet we always have these doubts. Would this happen? No, can that be done? What if we have signed a contract? Will this still be possible? Right, which I'll come to clarify to the extent possible. And then there are, of course, just to give you, this is the legal jargon, but each explanation widens, each proviso qualifies. Right? So that's the purpose. So in a way, we have more provisos qualifying what will be the scope of these things. But more importantly, categories are many, but they don't cover all works. Some of them extend to only videos, some of them extend only to software, some of them extend to literary, which is perhaps more relevant. Some of them may extend to all works, but not all categories extend to all works. So we need to keep referring back. We need to keep looking at it. And in a way, well, we have spelt out so many things. Does it mean good or bad? I would say it is good, because by spelling it out, we don't have to carve it out by interpretation later. So it's articulated in the law. Perhaps in a way it is better, because that way, otherwise I can be hauled up each time to say why you should interpret it as being fair, which is always a debatable issue. So in a way, our law articulates a lot of these things, so we can just refer to it and claim the remedies. I think we are all familiar with it. I'm not sure I need to spend too much time here. I have underlined only those aspects which are considered contentious. Though they spell it out so clearly, there are still issues, right? So I have just carved out some relevant things. I'm sure there may be even more. I mean, there are more, but they may be even more found relevant by your experience. So can libraries, and each time I mention library, of course, I really don't know whether there is there a definition of public library in any document? Is there a definition of any source which would say what is a public library? Because our law uses non-commercial public library. I'm not sure what does that mean. I look at it as every library is public, because that's what access means, right? It's not free to public, it is open to public. Right? And non-commercial, well, that's a different issue. I mean, whether commercial under copyrights law, typically commercial is a higher threshold. Reasonable pricing, recovering of cost, none of those are considered as commercial. Right? Commercial means it would have to be something which is profitable, right? Something which is far greater than merely charging some money. So in a way, I'm not sure if any of, at least correct me if I'm wrong, but most of our libraries perhaps would certainly qualify to be termed as library under this term. And so should we make electronic medium, I mean, can we convert a book into a scanned copy or an electronic copy only for purpose of storing? Can it be used for access? Because the law says storing, right? So can it be also used for printing out a couple of pages as and when necessary instead of using the book, right? So debatable, but I would say yes, storing need not be interpreted very narrowly. Perhaps we can go beyond. Of course, three copies is very well established. This again is becoming an issue thanks to e-commerce. Right, not available for sale in India. What if it is available on Amazon? Would it amount to being available for sale in India? Right, again, we need to take a look at that. Unpublished and anonymous work, of course, can be published or reproduced. Reasonable extracts, you know, I think libraries are becoming more and more places of events, places of congregations, places of knowledge communities. So, which basically means we must have the liberty to kind of have some kind of readings, reviews, and so on and so forth. And this has been a subject of great litigation in India as well. And to a large extent, I think we seem to have settled the point that when we say, you know, typically this was being termed as a in the course of instruction as a verb, but now the Delhi High Court seems to have clarified that no, it's not just doing the instruction, it is the entire context of instruction. So in a way, we are talking about education as a whole, as a program. So it includes any activity going towards course of instruction. So it's not just subject course. It's not subject. It's not a particular, it's not a particular offering of a course. So as you can see, there are quite a few subjective aspects. We use in our law the term fair dealing. We don't use the term fair use. What's the difference? Semantics, but yes, to a large extent, we exempt activities. We don't rely on, if you do it in this way, we exempt. Debatable whether we exempt all activities in that manner, because some of them are, if you notice in the previous slide, reasonable extract. Right? So there it is not activity, it is a quantitative parameter. Right? So in a way, we can't really paint the entire provision uniformly, but surely we can take refuge in the fact that we would like to look at it as long as we believe your activity is fair, we may not really look at. And Delhi High Court has gone to the extent of saying we won't look at what quality, what quantity, which is what this formula is about. You know, I'm sorry, that acronym is not mine. It is the first letter of each of those provisions. It's the purpose, the amount, the impact, and the nature of the work. Right? So it's a question of whether. So in many countries, US, Australia, Canada, New Zealand, South Africa, UK, right? UK follows a mix of both. They use some principles. They also list out for, you know, for example, by press, review, media, they exempt certain activities, including for education, research, teaching, education, and research. So when we talk about fair use, it is all about whatever may be your use, you got to use this criteria and see whether it's fair. When we talk about fair dealing, it is as long as it is in the course of instruction, as long as it is done by a library, it's fair. Right? The law would like to consider it as being exempted from legal actions or contractual implications. So, digital materials increasingly becoming very relevant, critical. Perhaps there are people saying tomorrow there will not be any non-digital form of material, so we don't know. But be that as it may, surely we are going into a world of more and more technology, media, media in terms of you know, the various forms of medium on which we store information. And each one of them, it becomes very easy to bind you into contracts. Unlike you don't have to sit and sign physical copies, you just click and you're already bound by 150 clauses. So it becomes very easy to bind you, trap you, encircle you, and surely, I'm sure, I don't know if I'm right in saying that before clicking, yes, it's not that we'll sit and read each of those 150 clauses. And even if we read, there's no guarantee we'll understand the actual implication, right? So in a way, it's, we are in that world, we better accept it. But surely, please note, universally and in India as well, whenever we can interpret the law in one manner and contract in another, the law will always prevail, right? Let there be no doubt about it. In fact, you know, Indian Contract Act is of 1872 vintage, and that defines contract pretty much for I mean, that was UK law, which we which was also applicable in India, and we have continued to continue to use it. That particular contract act defines contract as any agreement legally enforceable, right? So I keep telling people that contract killing is a misnomer. Right, I can't go to court and say I gave him a contract to kill someone, but he didn't finish the job. Please ask him to finish it. That's not possible because it's not a contract. It's an agreement, but not legally enforceable. Right? So there is no qualms of, no, but I've already agreed. Am I not bound? I'm bound only to the extent law enforces it. Right? Even if I have signed, even if I know I'm not bound and I have signed, no problems, as long as I am able to take refuge in some provision of the law vis-a-vis, I mean. And please note, when we talk about location, e-commerce, technology, n number of times this issue has come up, wherever I use the technology is the law applicable. It is not the law as stated in the contract that is applicable. Right? Because that's what the law of India says. If you are using it in India, Indian law will apply. No, but I have agreed to some other law to apply because I have signed an agreement with a US digital supplier. But Indian law says Indian law will apply. Where is the question of that law applying? Right? There is no question of this conflict, and even if there is a conflict, no doubt there could be a conflict, the one which will prevail will be the law of this land if you wish to enforce it here. Right. So are they governed by licensing conditions? Yes, but not entirely. Right. So though you don't end up negotiating this contract, you don't really have to be worried, because there are issues where the law will come into place. Of course, this has become a very important aspect. We amended our Copyrights Act in 2012 or 2013. Worldwide, it is becoming clear that technology is enabling more and more access to the people who are disabled. So then comes the issue of, but can libraries act as catalysts in order to enable better access, in order to be the fulcrum of enabling better access for people with disabilities? I think yes. In fact, the very purpose of amending our law was meant to provide libraries and institutions who otherwise work for the disabled to come together and enable better access through digital, electronic, retrievable, accessible formats for the disabled. Of course, that remains as a concern, is that, I mean, not as a concern, but as a limitation, that you must do so after having bought a legitimate copy, and then you go on to extend that coverage. Right? And my last point is to do with, you know, technology comes with technology-enabled safeguards. And for every safeguard, there's an antidote in technology. You know, even before technology software is made, a patch of that software is made. So in a way, there are always digital locks and a way to unlock that particular aspect. But without having to make it look like something illegal, what matters is, can we use technology as long as the ultimate purpose is fair? If the law is giving me that avenue and I am wanting to claim that avenue, be it as an institution, be it as a library or as an individual, if my ultimate claim is to be fair, can I use technically an unfair means to achieve fair purpose? It appears our law seems to be allowing it, unless there is some other interpretation of it. I would look at it as, it is not a problem as long as it is only for a purpose that is eventually claimed and established as fair use. I would have ideally said this provision kind of goes back to that saying, you know, everything is fair in love and war, but this is not the right time to speak about war and things like that. So let me conclude with that and take questions. Any, if you want to share experience, that's great, because this is a wonderful forum where we can learn from each other. Has there been a way that you have been able to provide better access? Has there been a way to provide better, retrievability? It's wonderful, right? So I'm open to questions. Please. Okay. Okay, you're asking me to read it as well. All right. No. It's a good... Is it a good practice to include a clause that any legal dispute to be taken to an Indian court? Okay, great question. I would say don't even bother. Because the law says in India, if you are an Indian citizen, Indian registered entity, or Indian... or even though I am a multinational entity, but functioning out of Indian territory, the law says any dispute pertaining to that entity, the courts of India are available as a jurisdiction. Of course, law doesn't say that court will come proactively, obviously. You know, court has enough to do. So you can go to court. The court has jurisdiction to look into that matter. So what if I have agreed to some other court? Will it mean I am denying Indian court? No citizen, no institution, no contract can either grant a power to a court nor take it away, right? It's already decided by the law. So there is no question of. So you don't even have to worry. In fact, if the other party says, no, we want to insist on US court, go ahead. Make it look like as if you're doing them a favor, because anyway, it is not binding. Right? Saying it is US court is of no consequence, because I can still drag them to court in India, and if they want to really enforce any remedy against me, they need to come to India. Of course, the fact is we are not entering into a contract only to violate it or anything. We, bona fides are extremely present. I'm not sure if that's...
Yeah, no, this is fine. There's one question, let me read for you.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. So is it mandatory to register copyright?
No. As you know, you might have seen that C within a circle is good enough. Anybody who uses C within a circle voluntarily means the law would say, we will take it as if you are asserting your copyright. That is good enough. You could also register and make it R within a circle, no problems. And sometimes a lot of people do, if especially they would like to convey a message to the outside world, we mean this to be very serious and high stakes, commercial stakes are running. In fact, copyrights, unlike trademarks and others, are even better, because as long as you put C within a circle, there are 176 other countries, including India 177, countries which have signed a treaty saying, if your country citizen or your country institution uses C within a circle and publishes something, we will protect it in our country as well. Right? So that's a coalition of more than 175 countries coming together to say, just your assertion of C within a circle is good enough. However, they don't offer you that solution if, what if the same material has been used by another citizen of another country by using C within a circle, then that's a dispute, you've got to work it out. Right? But otherwise, it's automatically you get international, in a way, if I may use that word, international protection. Though, as you know, all IPRs are territorial. Right? If I have a copyright, it's valid only in India, but respected and recognized across the world. In other IPRs, you've got to have registered it to get that international protection. But in copyrights, not even that is required. So C within a circle is important. And that is why C within a circle, your name, or all rights reserved. There are multiple ways of saying it. You can even put a year to show that version, that edition, and whatever. But C within a circle is a very important symbol. Yeah.
Next question is, can I give access to a subscribed content to different centers located in other cities of my institute without additional paying additional charges?
Okay, good point. See, surely when we talk about digital content, the licenses are very restrictive and tight. And when we talk about digital content, they make it very clear. In fact, sometimes they give it as one user, 10 user, right? So that one user, 10 user can be anywhere, as long as you are permitting them. So sometimes it may be number based, sometimes it may be IP address based, sometimes it may be, just terminal based. This computer will use it. So if that computer breaks for some reason, then you got to, of course, our law provides one backup copy is possible. But subscription is a different issue, because subscription, there's nothing called copy, you got to access. And if you're accessing from another terminal, it needs to be authorized. So given these restrictions, and these restrictions are legal, are enforceable. So you've got to bargain and negotiate. So a simple answer to that question is, no, you cannot extend it by, even though they may be fully belonging to you, you're fully the owner, or they happen to be just outlets, franchises, or whatever may be the connection. Digital subscription account, difficult. They would not allow. In fact, I don't know if you're aware, Microsoft and Karnataka High Court had a dispute long time back, because Karnataka High Court said, we will take one Windows copy, MS Windows, and use it wherever Karnataka High Court has jurisdiction. right? So they said we will use it across all the, at that time, 27 districts, across all the district courts in every district, because Karnataka High Court has got supervisory jurisdiction over this. Of course, you can't tell Microsoft to sue Karnataka High Court in Karnataka High Court. That would have been a pretty futile exercise. So they did go back and tell them that, sorry, that won't be possible. And the court eventually did say, yes, that's too creative a interpretation. They eventually settled that matter. But the answer is no.
Okay, the next question, I believe it is from Mr. Sridhar.
Yeah.
Oh, okay, just if I...
You got the answer?
Great.
Okay, but you have something called Systematic Download Confusion, Avoidance of Digital Millennium Act of...
Is there any relief for these three? The whole, like systematic download restriction,
okay.
Confu guidelines, and the Millennium Act of US.
The DMCA 2000, yeah. See, in fact, whatever may be the, I suppose what you are referring to is if these are restrictions. I believe that my previous slide, in a way, would say that, you know, when we talk about any kind of restrictions or digital, measures which are meant to safeguard against excessive or unauthorized use, can they be subverted, bypassed, denied, or in any manner technologically disabled, provided your purpose is for fair use, right? And let me assure you, just like how we are working at it, there are a battery of law firms and lawyers working at tightening the clauses. But as a broader principle, very clearly, can I do it without having to bat an eyelid and put in place a software which will bypass the barring me from any kind of downloads or more downloads than these many copies, provided you're doing it for something that you can claim fair use. So can we do it for course reading material? Yes. Can we do it for allowing students access some material as part of an educational program? That it appears with the Delhi High Court judgment and a lot of these things are getting a bit clarified. But are they legal, technical safeguards? Yes. Are they enforceable? Yes. Be it DMCA Act or not, they are enforceable as a license condition in India. Though DMCA Act is a separate issue in US, in India they are enforceable as license conditions. I don't want to say don't worry about it. No, we must worry about it. But there is a pattern by which we can overcome it. I don't want to use the word subvert.
But Bishop, what happened to the previous question? That the educational institutions.
Yes.
And giving access to multiple locations. So that's something called educational retail income.
No, see
and,
that.
And we're paying for a for no particular amount for our institutions. And we're just extending.
That last part is the key part. Am I implementing the same course across all my centers?
Yes. Yes.
As in students are enrolling in different places, but we are now providing content to all these centers from one source, then it's not a problem. Right? But the issue was, I am doing it in my, I have subscribed it here, I am doing it here, can I now give it to somebody else? Because they will do it, that's a different issue.
No, I'm talking.
Yeah, if the source is the same, beneficiaries are spread across, not a problem.
Yeah, like Bangalore got a different center in different location and two years.
No, we are talking of program, not institution.
Okay.
Program, education program as such. Now, I am Bangalore may have many centers, but we may not be doing the same program in every center.
Okay.
That is a catch.
So, well, I think I'm violating my own rule.
No.
What actually means that IIM Bangalore, this center is offering a program. Students from maybe Abu Dhabi or somewhere registering, so there. But if IIM say they have, an IIM Bangalore have another center, say Dubai, they are conducting a program. Resource that we subscribe from IIM Bangalore, can we allow IIM Dubai to use it?
No. But the first part is valid.
Yeah, I understand. Because they are all coming to this center.
Yeah.
Okay, next question. Rama, you? Yeah, I have got it. So another question is that 2012 amendment allows me to make a digital copy of all my books I have in the library. Can I make it accessible on my intranet?
This is regarding the disabled access, right? 2012 was the amendment.
No, in
normally, you see, can you show that you can store a copy, right?
Of, okay.
Yeah.
One is that. Okay. I have a physical copy in the library and we want to make a digital copy. What can we do with it? Can I take that question that way? Okay. First and foremost, it is still debatable as to whether store means can I then make it accessible, right? As of today, we haven't opened that up except for the disabled, right? The 2012 Act made it very clear that for the disabled, you may store it not just in whatever format may be accessible, you can store it. You can even print from a digital stored aspect in order to enable better access for disabled as such. And disabled, mind you, it's not a prefix of disabled. It's not only visually disabled, or it's a completely welfare interpretation. Can it be made available on internet? No.
Intranet,
because it is not under that store provision, it will be under the issue of for use by the people who are in the educational. That's right. It is basically used either by students or by staff or by the faculty. Yes. Right? To that extent, yes. But what if anybody from outside come and log into the intranet? Is that a free access allowed for intranet? Then that intranet loses that, the intranet is no longer intra. So therefore, that part we need to be careful about.
So just, it has to be authorized users,
yes.
Very restricted sense.
And authorized, what do you call it?
Within the campus.
Authorized users who have an affiliation within the campus, with the education purpose.
Next question is that can Government of India publications under restricted access be downloaded under fair use? Is that question, Kishore?
Okay. See, first...
Was it that question? You download? Yeah.
Okay. First and foremost, you know, let me start at a broader level. Usually, be it international level agencies, IMF, World Bank or WTO like that, or be it central government, state government institutions, typically, they are not restrictive about, they don't restrict documents on the basis of copyrights. They restrict documents on the basis of confidentiality. And that is a separate basis altogether. And when government says this is confidential document, and let us assume somebody else puts it out, and we make a copy, it's illegal. It's against the law. So fair use applies only for copyright purposes. Fair use acts do not make everything that we do in this way as fair. It is only for purposes of copyright assertions it is fair. And typically, please note, government rarely makes things confidential. If they make it confidential, then it means it is something of serious nature and it's not to be meddled with.
Next question is, but I know the answer of this question. Can a walk-in user who is not a student of the institute have access to digital content? My answer is your license agreement will tell. Each license agreement you have to read who are the beneficiaries. If they say walk-in user, irrespective of the affiliation with the institute, then it is yes. But if they say that no, then you cannot. So it varies. In my understanding, it can vary from one resource to another resource. If you have 100 resources, for 40 resources, there may be restrictions.
Yes.
But there are other 60 resources, maybe no restrictions.
Yeah.
I think I'm correct.
Yes, absolutely. I'm glad that you mentioned it correctly. And one aspect is there is some movement, especially after the Delhi High Court judgment, saying that, if one individual using it for oneself in a library, should we not consider it as, in a way, for private purpose being enabled and things like, they opened up the discussion, but we come back to that same thing. Digital content especially come under very severe restrictions, and typically they restrict numbers as well as nature of users, and in a way they are constructed to ensure that you are not in a position to permit anybody who can just happen to walk in or access other resources will also automatically get to access this. That automatic sense is not there.
So I have a last quote.
Yeah.
I think I must tell this audience that most of the librarians, in Bangalore have benefited from his earlier seminar. And I wish I had met him before publishing my paper in EPW. It would have been completely different. Uh-huh. But I have one question where I attended a copyright workshop in NDLI. What they say is that Delhi High Court judgment is confined only to that particular case, and you cannot use it as a precedent, where it allows the students also to take pictures in smartphone. That is one. And the other thing is, in circumstances, in emergency circumstances, where you have to teach a course and the content is not available, do the courts allow the concept of good faith? Though nothing is defined in law. So I can actually take that infringement, not to be taken seriously because it is an act of good faith, because I also record that why I have used a content which is not supposed to be or may not have the permissions to use.
Okay. So let me address the first part thing. Please note, High Court judgment is yes, in a way, because Supreme Court is the law of the land. Whatever Supreme Court says. So in a way, High Court of Delhi means it is surely applicable within Delhi, but it surely has, because High Courts are also court of record, it has full precedent value on that issue, that provision, that particular law related interpretation anywhere in India for sure. And in the absence of any conflicting judgment, then that will be the can I take a decision today based on that interpretation of Delhi High Court judgment? Yes. Within India, it is very much a valid source of interpretation of that law. Nobody can say that, no, how can you rely on Delhi thing? In fact, in tax, it happens almost on a daily basis. Bombay High Court would have said something. Bangalore traders will accordingly work on that because there is a favorable interpretation, unless tax authority goes to Karnataka High Court and gets it nullified by saying, no, they may have said something there, but here in this context, it's different. So till then, Delhi High Court will rule the firmament, and I don't know, they have decided not to go and appeal further. So in a way, that's quite prevalent. Coming to the next part, you're very right. Good faith is the purpose behind fair use. I mean, in another way, it's called fair use. So in a sense, is there good faith over and above fair use? No, but I have done it without really intending to. Perhaps the consequences will be accordingly, lenient or accordingly be blunted, because it was never meant to be, and perhaps expediency and whatever else, we tried to reach out, we could not, and we had to do it, whatever, so that the consequences will be lenient. But will it make it fair simply because it was done with no intent? No, intent is not so much an issue. What matters is purpose, right? And the purpose being fair, then we don't have to worry about intent.
Any other slip? Anybody has to pass any slip? Do you have, Arun, something you're writing now?
You can state it also.
Stand.
See, I mean, I put it in a very graphical way, but not to be mistaken, but universally, copyrights and trademarks, these are the two IPRs for which violation is also having criminal remedies. Right? These are the only two, patents, geographical indications, traditional knowledge, those are not there. So in India, it is, just to give you, what is the maximum personal thing, 2 years rigorous imprisonment. Right? I know I'm putting it in a graphical way, and you know, under the law, rigorous means people have to work in the jail. And I mean, not that I've experienced, I'm just telling you the knowledge, but as opposed to simple imprisonment, which is, you know, we just go sit, they feed us well and this thing. But anyway, but very, very rare, because at the end of the day, courts realize that criminal punishment is required only when there are a few more aspects of criminality involved. Otherwise, it is always compensatory punishment. Compensate whatever is the loss. When do we use the word compensate? It's only loss. So a publisher cannot take me to court and say, I didn't suffer a loss, but they still committed something. If it is zero loss, it is zero compensation. Right? There is no question of, no, just for having committed it, why don't you please wrap their knuckles with 1 lakh or 2 or 5 lakhs, this thing. No, there's no concept of penalties or anything. There may be issues of imprisonment if there are certain aspects of public interest and things violated. But otherwise, its quantum is dependent upon what is the monetary valuation of the loss. Patents is different. Yeah, patents also is a very unique thing, because you know, the market understanding of patents is very commercial, very industrial, very market driven. So that's easier there. See, here, by my one act of violating copyrights of a book, a publisher may not necessarily be losing out anything. Though they have every right to take me to court and say what you did was wrong, fair enough. But then the question the court will ask is, so what is the loss? If the loss is zero, then the person is, yes, what you did was violation. However, there is no compensation that needs to be paid.